London, last Thursday night, the private office of Jack Straw.
Now, Mr. Straw, Pinochet's had his tests. Now we need to establish if you're fit enough.
Fit enough?
To be Home Secretary. Because high office can be quite a trial.
Well, fire away. I'm best on pink questions, by the way. Entertainment. Don't ask me anything about history, and I'm totally hopeless at yellow.
All right, well, we'll start with the easy ones. Name?
Jack Straw.
Year?
2000.
Why are you deporting alleged Nazi war criminal Konrad Kelesh to Australia?
Because, it's a long way away.
What about the damning evidence from the US Justice Department?
Was it are you being served?
And have you considered the Australian War Crimes Commission?
Yes, I know this. Roy Kinnear.
Does your attitude to that alleged murderer contradict your attitude to Pinochet?
I think I'll phone a friend.
You see, Mr. Straw, you're confused, demented. Why don't you just resign?
Ah, I do know this one. It's because I'm a spineless, cynical politician who's always passing the buck.
Is the right answer. Dead Ringers.
Good evening, I'm Hugh Edwards. The headlines this evening. Half of Britain will own a mobile phone by next year, according to figures released today. But the... Oh, sorry about this. Hello? Oh, yes, yes. Well, fine, thanks, yes. Yeah, look, can you just... Yes, very nice New Year, thank you, yes. Well, I played Spin the Bottle at Moira Stewart's house. Oh, she's a lovely woman. Look, can you call me back? Okay, see you. Yeah, ciao, ciao. Sorry about that. With more on that mobile phone story, we go over live now to Peter Sissons, who's on the train.
Yes, hello. I'm on the train. I'm going to be late.
Thank you very much indeed, Peter. And now here's Isabel with the weather. I fancy her rotten.
Once upon a time, Mummy Blair and Daddy Blair found out that they were expecting Baby Blair. And they were very happy.
Oh, Daddy Blair, I'm so happy that my rather frightening Joker out of Batman-style outrageously large grin is even bigger than normal.
Yes, it certainly is, Mummy Blair. And what's funny is that when Baby Blair is born, it will look exactly like that nasty little William Hague who lives in the village.
Who? Baldilocks?
Yes.
When the baby's born, it'll be Baldilocks and the three Blairs.
Yes, wide smiles. Well, we'd better get you checked over, I suppose. I'll just book an appointment with our spin doctor.
And so Mummy Blair and Daddy Blair made preparations for the big day. They knocked through next door where the fat squatter lived, bought lots of baby clothes, and organised as many public relations exercises as they could fit in. Meanwhile, Baldilocks had found out.
Fionn, have you seen this? Mummy Blair and Daddy Blair are having a baby. Their ratings will go through the roof. What can we do?
Well, why don't we have one?
You are, you insane woman. We'd have to have sex first.
Oh, God. Oh, yeah, I never thought about that.
Oh, it's no good. I'm just going to have to steal all of Daddy Blair's policies instead.
And so Baldilocks broke into the three Blairs' house and started going through all of Daddy Blair's policies.
Right, let's try this one. Oh, no, a bit too far to the left for me.
So he tried another policy.
Oh, no, a bit too similar to many of my own.
But the third policy was just right.
A private-public split on ownership of the London Underground. I'll have that.
So Baldilocks stole the policy and ran back into the scary woods, where a big, ugly, horrible, weird monster tried to gobble him up.
Michael Portillo, what are you doing here?
And that's the end of our Tory.
White smile and starry eyeballs. Well, you're listening to the Today programme. It's a little after 18 minutes past eight. Now, England's cricketers out in South Africa have lost yet another test series, and there's rumours that they've simply run out of new excuses. Nasser Hussain joins me now. Nasser, is it true?
No, it's not true. John, no. Bags of new excuses. Mm-hmm. We lost because there was an alien spaceship hovering around the ground, and it was metallic, and the gleam from the ship caused our middle-order batsmen to be dazzled. and things.
Well, I'm just hearing from Bill Frindle that that excuse was first used in 1930 by Johnny Won't Hit Today Douglas.
Right.
So,
yeah. We lost because of badgers.
Hmm.
Yeah, during the tea interval, the dressing room was invaded by badgers.
Well, I'm sorry, Nasser, but that was used when we lost in the World Cup by
Alex Stewart last summer.
Yes, Alex Stewart, that's right. Now, Nasser, why can't you just admit that England are rubbish?
OK, I admit it. We're no good.
Ah, at last.
We're no good. Because of the Millennium Bug. come on, no one's used that one before, isn't it? It's topical.
Jerry, I believe you have some demands.
Thank you, Senator Mitchell. I'd like the IRA to keep its weapons, and I want an end to all Orange Order marches in Northern Ireland forever.
Reverend Paisley?
I want to see this! Mr. Adams, that's fine by me.
How refreshing. How Heineken.
Hey, may I attach his name, please?
My name is the Doctor.
Pardon?
My name is the Doctor. You asked my name.
No. What name are you looking for, sorry?
Oh, I'm very sorry. Do forgive me. I'm looking for the Master.
The Master?
Yes.
And you're the Doctor?
Yes, I need to speak to him very urgently.
And what's this about?
I've got a very important job to do, one that involves the entire future of your species. Now, what is the number of the Master?
Master?
He is in Gallifrey.
Gallifrey?
Yes.
How are you spelling Gallifrey?
G-A-L-L-I-F-R-E-Y. Can you find that?
Master of a first name.
It has never been discovered. He is pure evil.
I'll just have a search for that then, okay?
I'm speaking to the man. He is in search of the Master.
Right, the Master, and he lives in Gallifrey.
Yes.
You don't have an address?
Yes, I do. Constellation of Casterbrus, 003.079 from Galactic Zero Centaur.
And your name again was?
I am the Doctor.
I'm not going to listen for that at all here.
You must listen to me. I renounce the Society of Time Lords. Now I am just a traveller.
You're a traveller? From where?
Yes. All right, well, if you can't find me that number, can you give me the number of a kebab shop? I'm worn out talking to you.
Cliff, oh, I'm telling you, I loved your Millennium Prayer.
Yeah, okay, only because you're my agent.
True. So let's do another and beat everyone to number one again.
Well, I've already got one. It's another familiar bit of the Bible and sung to a popular tune.
Right, yes. And?
The Ten Commandments sung to the Hokey Cokey. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill. Steal, kill, steal, kill, or cover thy neighbor's house. Honor mum and dad, don't hear the Lord's name in vain. And that's what it's all about. All do the Ten Commandments. All do the Ten Commandments. All do the Ten Commandments. Here comes Moses, rah, rah, rah.
Welcome to the second series of Walking with Dinosaurs. Once again, the BBC has consulted the finest minds in paleontology and archaeology to establish exactly how these prehistoric creatures lived their lives. And we haven't just made up loads of stuff like last time, honest. Tyrannosaurus rex, the fiercest meat-eater of the late Cretaceous era. He has small, spindly forelegs which are of little use, but very strong back legs. From this, we can safely assume that this majestic creature was a tap dancer. Adept in a variety of steps, this fearsome beast would approach his prey from heavy undergrowth, better to mask the distinctive sounds of his tap shoes. But was the greatest hunter the earth ever known wiped out by the onset of disco? Tyrannosaurus Rex, the first of the great accomplished soft shoe shufflers. Or maybe he just used those legs to run with. We'll never know for sure, but I know which one makes better telly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.